Well, welcome everybody. It's great to see you all. Just to remind you, feel free to get real comfortable. Make sure you can see the screen. I know that Dr. Kim will, I think, project some of his lecture notes. So there'll be some narrative up there, and you want to make sure you could see that. Really happy that he and his wife are here. They are based this semester at the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley. Just happy that they were able to make this mini trip here to Westmont. They've been here before. I think the first time was about 10 years ago. And then Nathan and I overheard your conversation maybe about three, four years ago?
Yeah, so when I was a freshman.
3 years.
So, yeah, it's incredible. But really delighted that Dr. Kim is here with us. Dr. Hyup-Yung Kim comes from South Korea. He had a distinguished career at Kangnam University and retired a few years ago. He did his Master of Divinity and Master of Theology at Princeton Theological Seminary, actually after graduating from, was it Seoul National? Okay, I got that right. Seoul National in Seoul, Korea. And then he did a PhD in theology at the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley, otherwise known as the GTU. He was a senior fellow at Harvard University's Center for the Study of World Religions, and he's also been connected to Oxford University and Cambridge University. This semester, as I mentioned, he's based in Berkeley at the Graduate Theological Union, and he's the distinguished Asian theologian there this semester. Also, a few years ago, was the distinguished alum of the Graduate Theological Union. Some of his interests, and they're very wide, theology of religions, Asian theology, science and religion, particularly that dialogue between science and religion. Some of his books include Christ and Tao, another book, Theology of the Tao, or Theology of Tao, and Wang Yangming and Karl Barth, a Confucian-Christian dialogue that was a manuscript written a while back. This lecture is sponsored by two funds that we have here at Westmont. One is the World Christianity Fund, and the other is the Adams Mission Fund. And we're delighted to have access to those funds that give us a chance to welcome guests, whether they're flying in from San Francisco or all the way from Seoul, Korea. Today, his lecture is going to be an ecological theology of Tao or eco-Tao. One thing I really appreciate about Dr. Kim is I always think of him as both very courageous, sometimes getting into some trouble because of that, but then also very creative. So courageous and creative. He mixes the inherited categories that we just take for granted, and he pushes them in ways that I think are really helpful. Not everything that he says is received easily. There's a lot of pushback, and I think that's good. I've attended the American Academy of Religion with him. I've seen him in action there. So, and one thing also about Dr. Kim is his work is very personal, and that's something else I appreciate about him as a person. When he was learning theology, particularly doing his PhD work, he never bifurcated theology from who he was and is as a person from East Asia. And he's been on an incredible journey trying to blend those two things together. So anyway, we're really happy that you're here. And thanks to both the Kims for making the journey. And welcome to Westmont.
Thank you, my friend Charlie Faladin. I always have problem to pronounce your last name.
But
actually, I'm the one. Actually, he put. I made him in crisis when he had when he is in tenure review. He invited me to come here, and I criticize American missionaries in Asia.
Yeah.
One descendant, senior faculty is here, and I think you have the problem to get tenure because that. But still, he liked me, and then he even invited me. Thank you so much. It is my honor to be here again. Today, I'm trying to present kind of a provocative idea for ecology. Well, I have been thinking for decades on this line, but still it is minority in world academia. Of course, scholars are recognized nowadays because they ask me again and again chapters in handbook, such as the T.N.T. Clark and Cambridge and so on and so forth. But today I really pleased and happy to present this kind of the theologian of ecology for a student here and faculty here. Okay, let me begin. First, my name is Hubyung Kim, but American library dictate my name in their way of romanization, Kim Hubyung. So if you want to research on my work, you need both names. So that is interesting. Okay. I will read, and then because of my strong Korean accent, sometimes you misunderstand, so I prepare manuscript here. So I will go through that, then you may have a better understanding. It is a little bit loaded paper, but I believe even freshmen of Westmont understand my complicated book, Theology of Tao, so I'm very happy to hear that. Tao is an overarching concept for East Asian thought. With its adoption as the root metaphor, I have proposed that the theology of Tao, namely Theo Tao, is a proper paradigm that the theology in this age to think of toward a theology without words, or trans-religious theology. I don't know whether you have heard this, but this is kind of a hot issue in American Academy of Religion these days. Theo Tao aims to surmount the chronic dualism of contemporary Christian theology between the paradigm of traditional theology, theologos, which are a classical and inculturationalist theologies and its modern alternative, theopraxis, liberation theologies. As its Chinese character, this is the Chinese character, consists of two ideographs, head, meaning head, knowing, and bhikkhu, acting. Tao connote holistically both the source of knowing, which is logos, and the way of acting, praxis in unity. That is to say, the logos in transformative praxis, or the praxis in transformative logos. Hence, Tao, a holistic root metaphor, does not force want to choose between either logos or praxis, but embraces the whole of both ends to enable a person to participate in a dynamic movement to be united in the cosmic thread. The Tao, also meaning ultimate reality, embodies the transformative praxis of cosmic trajectory of life in the unity of knowing and acting. Logos, the dominant root metaphor of Christian theology for the last two millennia, is rooted in the Greek hierarchical dualism and further reduced to technical reason by the influence of modernism. Thus, it has become an inappropriate root metaphor for ecological theology. Instead, I argue, Tao is a more proper root metaphor for the theology of ecology and life. First of all, Tao is most life-affirming root metaphor, according to Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Green, who is leading a Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology. Further, as homologous to Hodos in the Biblical Greek, it is a more biblical term than logos. Jesus said, "I am the way, Hodos, truth and life," John 14:6a. That is to say, the ultimate way, Tao of life. Jesus did not identify himself as the incarnate logos, but rather as the Tao toward God. Furthermore, the original title for Christianity was Hodos, which was translated as Tao in the Korean Bible, various passages in Acts. So this is kind of a diagram, summary of that, but I will go through my manuscript. It's the core of Taoist thought is to return or act according to the nature as it is. Neo-Confucianism also adopts this thought emphatically. In Chinese character, nature means self-soul, spontaneity, or naturalist. That is the effective modality of the system that informs the actions of the agents that compose it. In other words, nature in East Asian thought is the primary self-soul, natural manifestation of Tao, the way. Tao is an ideal root metaphor for ecology, because its ontology, cosmology, and spirituality per se are precisely ecological. For this reason, I propose to make use of Tao as the root metaphor for a proper paradigm of ecological theology, namely Eco-Tao. Furthermore, the ontocosmology of Tao, the great ultimate, entails profoundly a sense of cosmogenesis or cosmogony, which Thomas Berry and Brian Swind, one of the pioneers for ecological theology and philosophy from Catholic side, advocated with their prophecy of the ecozoic era in their well-known book, University Story. An axiotic view of Confucianism is the anthropocosmic vision, which means unity of heaven, cosmos, and humanity, anthropos, that affirm the mutual dependence and all organic unity of heaven and humanity. The doctrine of Min, one of the Confucian four books, in the beginning, it states, what heaven imparts to human is called human nature. To follow our nature is called the way Tao. Cultivating the way is called education, unquote. This anthropocosmic vision sees humanity, anthropology, is inseparable from heaven, cosmology, and conceived as its microcosm. Hence, East Asian anthropology is cosmocentric in contrast to anthropocentric approach to cosmology prevalent in the West. This anthropocosmic view presents inclusive humanism, which Confucian scholar, who was a University of Hawaii professor, Cheng Chung-ing, sharply distinguished with exclusive humanism, dominant in the West since Descartes' dualistic rationalism, whereas exclusive humanism exalts the human species, placing it in a position of mastery and domination over the universe. Inclusive humanism stresses the coordinating powers of humanity as the very reason for its existence. Chen continued his sharp criticism on Western exclusive humanism, but I will skip here. And he argued the inclusive humanism rooted in Confucianism focused on human person as an agency of both self-transformation and transformation of reality at large. As the self-transformation of person is rooted in reality, and the transformation of reality is rooted in the person, there is no dichotomy of bifurcation between the human and reality. Over against the essentialist and exclusivist view of the human person, inclusive humanism stress betweenness or amongness of the person. The Chinese character for the human being means in betweenness. This word is betweenness. This character means human. In inclusive humanism, a person is not so much a static substance or an isolated ego as a network of relationship in constant change. This relational vision of being in continual change is called ontocosmology. This Confucian Taoist, therefore Neo-Confucian ontocosmology, is basically related to the notion of the great ultimate. In an explanation of the diagram of the great ultimate, Chinese scholar, 11th century, Zhu Doni stated, "The ultimate of non-being, and also the great ultimate through movement generates yang. When its activity reaches its limit, it becomes tranquil. Through tranquility, the great ultimate generates yin. When tranquility reaches its limit, activity begins again. So movement and tranquility alternate and become the root of each other, giving rise to the distinction of yin and yang, and the two modes are thus established." This is very important cosmology for East Asian people, not only Confucianism, but also Taoism. So you know, you see, this you can understand from this diagram. Precisely, this is Dai Ji, the great ultimate, and this is explanation of the great ultimate here, the diagram of supreme ultimate. This is diagram is written by Yi Tuege, Yi Huang, the most important Confucian scholar in Korea. The great ultimate symbolized by a circle enclosing yin and yang denote the complementarity of opposites. Complementarity of opposites. The circle signifies an inexhaustible source of creativity, which is one and undifferentiated. And the dynamic process of yin and yang interaction is always ready to be differentiated into concrete and individual things. It is the most fountainhead amidst all things and provides the integrity and purposive unity of any time or any individual token, while at the same time it also serves as the impetus for the diversity of things as types of token. The great ultimate, so conceived, entails precisely cosmogony of the Tao in the continual process of unity in multiplicity or diversity in unity. This Neo-Confucian ontocosmology is also pertinent to Taoism, as Da Zhe Jing state, Tao produced the one. The one produced the two, yin and yang. The two produced the three. And the three produced the 10,000 things. The 10,000 things carry the yin and embrace the yang. And through the blending of the material fourth important term again, qi. In Korean, gi, but in Chinese, qi. They achieve harmony. This statement refers to the dynamic creative process of Tao in the metaphorical symbolism of the great ultimate. It produced the one, the two yin and yang, and the three offering of yin and yang. The whole is both absolute and relative. It is both one, singularity, and two, plurality at the same time. The creativity of Tao is cosmogenetic process of great ultimate through the dynamic yin and yang interaction and always in the process of change. It stipulates the dialogical paradigm of harmony and equilibrium in East Asian thought, in contrast to dialectical paradigm of strife and conflict in Western thought. The great ultimate signifies both process and world qua, the totality of things, in which there is a profound equilibrium from the beginning and a pervasive accord or harmony among all things at any time. In this regard, the great ultimate is a prototype of a cosmogenetic principle which Thomas Berry and Brian Swim try to articulate as differentiation, anthropoiesis, and communion throughout time and space and every level of reality. Inclusive humanism, rooted in this ontocosmology of Tao, developed a vision of cosmic togetherness in an organismic unity with heaven, earth, and myriad things. In the Western inscription, Zhang Zhai, another 11th century Chinese Neo-Confucian scholar, beautifully expressed that heaven is my father and earth is my mother, and even such a small creature as I find an intimate place in their midst. Therefore, that which fills the universe I regard as my body, and that which lacks the universe I consider as my nature. All people are my brothers and sisters, and all things are my companions. This is not from Bible, but this is Neo-Confucian text. Wang Yangming, a 15th century Confucian scholar, further expanded this Echo-Daoian vision in his doctrine of the oneness of all things. The great person regards heaven, earth, and the myriad things as one body. He regards the world as one family and the country as one person. Forming one body with heaven, earth, and the myriad things is not only true of the great person, even in the mind of the small person is no different. Only he or she, himself or herself, makes it small. Here the universe is depicted as cosmic triune family and human being as a cosmic person, a member of the cosmic trinity. From this vantage point, a Confucian Christian idea of a trinity is suggested. We might see God the Son as the ideal human. God the Father would be heaven, the creative spirit, and God the Holy Spirit, the earth, the receptive co-spirit, an agent of the world which testifies to the accomplishment of the divinity. Qi, metacosmic energy. You know the Tai Chi and kind of Korean martial art, Taekwondo, whatever. So we now go into another notion, Qi. As in the cited passage of Lao Tzu is Earth of Da Te Ching, so same thing. Qi is regarded as the medium and the source of force to enable unification and harmony among all creations through interaction of yin and yang. For this reason, Mary Evelyn Tucker argued, the philosophy of Qi has profound potentiality as an ecological cosmology. However, qi is not just a philosophical or metaphysical notion, but also, more importantly, a physically materializing and ubiquitously embodying reality. However, it is difficult for the analytically and scientifically oriented modern mind to know and realize it. It requires purifying one's mind, in Christian term, kenosis, or self-emptying, to experience its subtle movement and covert reality through psychosomatic practices, which sometimes requires rigorously ascetic disciplines such as meditation, contemplation, yoga, and East Asian martial art. Most of all, proper breathing exercise are crucial. Zhuangzi, Taoist master in China, had a Confucius saying at the time of Confucius, "Make your will one. Don't listen with your ears, listen with your mind. No, don't listen with your mind, but listen with your spirit, qi. Listening stops with the ears, the mind stops with recognition, but spirit is empty and waits on all things. The Tao gathers in emptiness alone. Emptiness is the fasting of the mind." This passage stipulates three ways of knowing or attaining the enlightenment of Tao, namely objective, intuitive, and spiritual. The first way of knowing, which is epistemic, is based on an objective scientific observation through sensory organs such as ears and eyes. The second one refers to intuitive perception through the operation of the mind, psyche, which is, though more advanced than the first epistemic one, still remains within the limit of penultimate recognition. The final one is the right path to attain the enlightenment of Tao by a spiritual realization of qi, the metacosmic energy, in and through the human body. This accurate way can surpass flaws and limitations of the objective and the intuitive knowing. However, it needs a rigorous discipline of self-cultivation and self-emptying to attain emptiness or vacuity, which is the precondition to realize the movement of qi. Thus, Echo Tao as a new ecological theology underscores the realization of qi. However, it is not easy for the modern people to recognize qi, for its subtle and apophatic movement is beyond cognitive knowing and verbal expression, but needs to be realized in and through bodily experience, even beyond intuition, particularly through breathing. This point is crucial in this technocratic era, not only in a danger of total destruction of ecosystems, but also challenged by the movement of transhumanism that advocate the maximum use of science and technology to end up or upgrade the species of Homo sapiens to the post-human by substituting the problematic bio body with a Superman-like machine body. In this regard, the distinction of Thomas Berry between technozoic and the ecozoic is insightful and significant. The Reformation accelerated intensively anthropocentric turn of Christian theology and dissociated the anthropocosmic unity implicit in the medieval Christianity, and the Industrial Revolution promoted the use of modern science to massively exploit the body of the earth. Furthermore, transhumanists are now contributing a revolution for the extinction of the human body, preaching technozoic gospel for an omnipotent and eternal post-human without death and desires. However, the significance of breathing lies in the fact the cybernetic post-human with the machine bodies cannot breathe. Their source of energy is not metacosmic or life-giving energy like a chi, which is psychophysical and interpenetrating phenomenon, but just an electrical chemically working machine like a battery. Hence, I argue, spirituality of body and breathing in theory and in practice is what is imperative more to move in the echozoic and resist against the technozoic. The movie Star Wars is prophetic here, with the visionary slogan of Jedi Knight like Yoda, a messianic Taoist warrior, may the Qi force be with you. In fact, a simple way to experience and realize the Qi is to feel and discern its movement through the practice of breathing in and out. Zhuangzi said, all things that have consciousness depend upon breath. But if they do not get the feel of breath, it is not the fault of heaven. Heaven opens up and the passages and surprises them day and night without stop. But human being, on the contrary, blocks up. The Book of Chan stated the successive alteration of one yin and one yang is called Tao. This symbolic statement has profound philosophical implications and has produced manifold interpretation in the history of East Asian thought. Simply speaking, however, using the metaphors of yin and yang and Tao, figuratively describe the phenomenology of breathing, the way a life is sustained by successively alternating movement of inhalation in breathing air and qi in, and exhalation yang, breathing air and qi out. Another important point is that the term qi connotes not only the metacosmic energy, but also air in the sky. As air in the Chinese character literally means the qi in the emptiness. In the process of breathing, when inhalation reaches its limit, it alternates to the exhalation and vice versa. In the diagram of the great ultimate, therefore, there is an eye, small circle of yang inside of the yin, and another eye, a small circle of yin inside the yang. They symbolize the inness, exclusion of yang in the yin and of yin in the yang, or the existence of the inner connecting principle between yin and yang. When yin reaches its limit, it becomes yang and vice versa. This inner inside of inness or inner connecting principle in yin and yang resemble the notion of perichoresis, co-inherence in the Christian doctrine of Trinity, such as when, as Jesus said, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, John 14:11. Breathing is not just the process of the inhalation of fresh air with oxygen and the exhalation of used air, but also, more importantly, a bodily embodiment of qi in the process of this yin-yang alteration. Through breathing of qi, humans sustain in communion and communication with that of the universe. The qi involved in human breathing is the qi of universe. Heaven or nature and humans are basically not two. Hence, qi, life-giving metacosmic energy, and breathing, often mutually interchangeable terms, have profound spiritual implications for Eco Tao. This is similar to the passage of in Genesis, which states, "The Lord God formed human being from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath, chi, in the Korean Bible of Life, and the man became a living being." The spirituality ground on the ontocosmology of Great Artemis and the Kenotic Tao does not imply an abstract metaphysical cosmology or individually isolated ascetic discipline. On the contrary, the spirituality of Qi breathing entailed the concrete trajectory of a revolutionary and subversive life force. As the divine breathing in Korean Sum initiate the creation of cosmos and inspire the humans to life, it is a cosmogonic life force, life-giving force, Qi, that can make all things alive. A clue to understanding the mystery of a hidden but dynamic metacosmic power of Tao is the principle of reversal and the power of radical return. In the Christian Bible, New Testament, Jesus also speaks of principle of reversal. "Blessed are you that are hungry now, for you will be filled. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Whoever want to be first must be last of all. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." A vivid metaphor of Tao's radical power of return in a feeble fishes is a feeble fishes jumping up against the mighty downstream in order to return to its origin. Another reversal return metaphor in the Da Le Jing can be found in the gendered nature of yin and yang. Da Le Jing describes Tao with basically feminine metaphors, such as mother of all things and the mystical female. This feminine vision is based on Lao Ji, Da Le Jing, a principle of reversal. Lao Ji gave preferential option to the strategy of yin, weak, soft, small, empty, rather than yang, strong, hard, big, full. This in principle of reversal is closely connected with the principle of return. The principle of reversal and radical return entails the spirituality of Tao with the paradoxical power of weakness and emptiness. Eco Tao, embodied with East Asian spirituality of Tao, can strengthen ecological theology, extending in beyond Christian resources. The spirituality of Tao with the in principle of reversal and radical return, with the paradoxical power of weakness and emptiness, could empower resistance to merciless processes of genocide, biocide, and ecocide. In fact, this in principle is in accordance with the life act of Jesus. The life-saving mystery of his resurrection entails Christian principle of radical return, the victory of life over the power of death. His crucifixion on the cross denotes Christian principle of reversal with the paradoxical power of weakness and emptiness. And the yin strategy resonates with the biblical preferential option for the poor, famous idiom of liberation theology. However, the preferential option should be extended to the wounded ecosystem as a whole, including engendered species, in addition, minjung, the poor, women, the oppressed, and the underprivileged. Eco Tao and Laudato Si. The recent encyclical of Pope Francis on ecology, Laudato Si, is impressively resonant with the view of Eco Tao in various ways. First of all, the proposal for integral ecology is in favor of Eco Taoian project I have outlined here, making genuine dialogue with and utilizing our own religious and wisdom traditions beyond the world of traditional Western Christianity. The emphasis on cultural ecology is remarkable. This point is particularly significant for developing and developed countries in the global south, where the logic of development is still strong and robust, and where in many cases ecological destruction are creating greater dysfunctions with accompanying destructive of local religious and cultural traditions, which are irreversible in most cases. The document states, rather there is need to incorporate the history, culture, and architecture of each place, thus preserving its original identity. Ecology then also involves protecting the cultural treasures of humanity in the broadest sense. More specifically, it calls for greater attention to local cultures when studying environmental problems. Culture is more than what we have inherited from the past. It is also, and above all, a living, dynamic, and participatory present reality, which cannot be excluded as we rethink the relationship between human beings and environment. The document makes an imperative claim: ecology should be built in the context of constant and active involvement of local people within their proper culture. Furthermore, it asserts, nor can the notion of the quality of life be imposed from without. For quality of life must be understood within the world of symbols and customs proper to each human group. Secondly, the emphasis of universal interconnectedness resonates with the East Asian sea anthropocosmic or ontocosmological vision in the communicative unity of God, Earth, and humanity. Quote, the creation account in the book of Genesis contained in their own symbolic and narrative language suggest human life is grounded in three fundamental and closely intertwined relationships with God, with our neighbor, and with the earth itself. As already noted, St. Francis' ecological vision of cosmic family has many echoes of Neo-Confucian vision, as in the cited passage from Western inscription. Everything is related, and we human beings are united as brothers and sisters on a wonderful pilgrimage, woven together by the love God has for each of his creatures, and which also unite us in fond of affection with brother sun, sister moon, brother river, and mother earth. The Ecuadorian suggestion for social cosmic narrative of the exploited life is relevant to the document's point on the issue of biodiversity, global warming, and desertification, and so on. The new thesis of ecology and social justice issues is in accordance with Ecuadorian fusion of anthropocosmic vision and Minjung theology, Korean liberation theology. Hence, every ecological approach needs to incorporate a social perspective which takes into account the fundamental rights of the poor and the underprivileged. Thirdly, the critique of unhealthy dualism is in consonance with the Theodorian criticism of either-or mentality in the Western thought. The claim of the inseparability of spirit and body in a core claim of Theodao and Ecodao. Quote, the life of the spirit is not dissociated from the body or from nature or from worldly realities, but lived in and with them in communion with all that surround us. At this juncture, it is worth remembering Christianity with the doctrine of Trinity, both one and three, and Christology, both divine and human, already had overcome Greek dualism, either one or three, either divine or human. Further, the critique of modern anthropocentrism is honest and consistent with that of C.O. Dow. Modern anthropocentrism has paradoxically ended up prizing technical thought over reality, since the technological mind sees nature as an insensate order, as a cold body of fact, as a mere given, as an object of utility, as raw material to be hammered into useful shape. It views the cosmos similarly as a mere space into which objects can be thrown with complete indifference. Furthermore, that document assert, we no longer speak of sustainable development apart from intergenerational solidarity. The intergenerational solidarity has particularly significant implication vis-a-vis the challenge of transhumanism, which attempt to impose tyranny of the present over the future and over the past as well. Fourthly, the focus on humanism is a breakthrough in Christian theology. It is consistent with the Theodawian criticism of exclusive humanism developed under the influence of modern individualism. And it seems to endorse the Theodawian proposal for inclusive humanism based on the Confucian theanthropocosmic vision. We urgently need humanism capable of bringing together the different fields of knowledge, including economics, in the service of a more integral and integrating vision. The appeal for an integral ecology, for highlighting human ecology, sounds almost like Neo-Confucian statement. The document states that, quote, an integral ecology calls for openness to categories which transcend the language of mathematics and biology and take us to the heart of what it is to be human, unquote. Moreover, the document underlines the exercise of concrete spirituality such as ascetic practices, calling for ecological conversion with rejecting self-interested pragmatism. This is in accord with Ecodawian interest in self-cultivation, self-emptying, spiritual discipline of qi. I speak the five. Finally, the document presents a hint for Christian theology of a body in which Ecodao has a special interest. Christianity does not reject matter. Rather, bodiliness is considered in all its value in the liturgical act, whereby the human body is disclosed in its inner nature as a temple of the Holy Spirit and is united with the Lord Jesus, who himself took a body for the world's salvation. Thus, therefore, Ecodao and Laudato Si share many common points that enable mutually constructive and fruitful dialogue. Especially, I would like to highlight the spirituality of breathing and the inside and reality of qi, recuperating and outpouring metacosmic energy with the in principle of reversal and return. In and through constructive dialogue or new synthesis with the orthodox tradition of Jesus prayer and the liberation theology's insight of preferential option for the poor, respectively, for example, those Ecodawian perspectives could help develop a more concrete ecological theology and spirituality of incarnation for the Ecozoic era. These are only some examples for which Ecodao can make substantial contribution to ecological discourse in the years of to come, anticipating and foretelling the return of the Tao of Jesus Christ, attain complete equity, maintain steady first quietude, all things come into being, and I see thereby their return. All things flourish, but each one return to its root. This return to its root means tranquility. It is called returning to its destiny. To return to destiny is called eternal that is Tao. To know the eternal is called enlightenment. The person who knows the eternal is all-embracing. Being all-embracing, he is one with the nature. Being one with the nature, the person is in accordance with Tao. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have a few minutes. This is, I know, really new for, I'm sure, all of you. Is there a question or two for general clarification? I know there's a lot here that, again, is new, East Asian philosophy, etc. But is there anything in particular you would like some clarification on before we continue?
You said when you were talking about inclusive humanism that a person is not a static substance, but rather a network of relationships in change. And I was just wondering, because like at least the Greco-Western philosophical idea of a personhood is like a simple mind, single, unchanging substance. I was wondering if you could explain how a person as a network of relationships works.
Okay. In Korea, before Westernization, we don't have clear notion of I. Rather, we have a notion of we. Okay? So collective identity is actually primary for East Asian thinking. The sharp distinction between Western thinking and Eastern thinking is Eastern thinking is not based on essentialism, substantialism, okay? We don't try to find out building block. So, you know, Western science go in that direction. Rather, everything is relational, okay? Like yin yang in great alchemy, all right? So when you identify you, in Confucianism, you have to take care of five relationships to have your authentic existence. The first, your relationship with your parent, and then if you become adult, with your spouse, and relationship between elderly people and younger people, and relationship between friends. So they call five bonds. So in other words, the issue in East Asian anthropology or a notion of human being is in the beginning, as I told you again and again, your relationship to heaven. Okay? Humanity, by definition, according to very important Confucian text, Jung Yong, the first chapter, the first is humanity is heavenly endowment. So you cannot away from the heaven. Your existence and your identity is in relation to heaven. So some Western scholars even misunderstand there is kind of notion of transcendence in East Asia or East Asian thought, but that is misunderstanding. In other words, transcendence is already presupposition for being human. Okay? Human being is, because of heavenly endowment, he has power to be transcendent. Okay? So, very good question, but that is actually kind of sharp. But nowadays, East Asian are becoming sometimes more than Western. They like more individualism, mm-hmm. or substantialism. All right. So, notion, Freudian idea of isolated ego is not East Asian. Okay. Yeah.
What was the name of the book where the heavenly endowment? I missed
Jung Yong.
Jung Yong.
How would I spell that?
Sorry.
Yeah,
there are the Confucian classics, right?
Yeah.
Or
Go to Google or whatever. Just say Confucian Classics.
Yeah.
There are four books. It's the normally called Doctrine of Means. Doctrine of Means.
Okay. Thank
okay?
You.
Yeah. Thank you. So it looks all understood.
I don't think so. I mean, it's hard to know how to engage something that's... But yin and yang, you have there on the slide, the return of the Tao of Jesus Christ. Are you suggesting that... well, let me ask this. It's kind of a question to set this up. So yin would be the force of the passive, right? Yin or in. Yang would be more Confucian. Would you say that or not?
So don't try to put into static notion.
Yeah, yeah.
So yin and yang is always changing. So, yeah, kind of the other kind of characteristics is kind of temporary.
Yeah.
So, even when you Confucianism, particularly according to I Ching, Book of Chen, you are male in appearance.
Right.
You are inside can be, you look young, but inside you are more in than woman.
Right.
So we don't see just fixed you are young or fixed male or whatever.
Yeah.
So actually it is always yin and yang combination.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you have a family compound in your mind, your appearance is young. So that is kind of a relationship. And then that relationship is not fixed, always change.
Yeah.
So life is in always change. Yeah. Without change, that's cancer, you die.
Yeah.
So you breathe in and breathe out, you survive, you live. You just breathe in, you die. You just breathe out, you die.
Yeah.
But some Western thinking is trying to fix.
Yeah.
Whether it is breathing in or breathing out,
Or
whether it is yin or yang, then you die.
Okay, so let me ask you this. It's a little off, but several students have read Shishako Endo's Silence.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you've read it, but you have there the silence of God and his apparent absence. And, where's the water? Need more water?
Okay.
Okay. I'm wondering here in your presentation, you've just mentioned the complementary forces of yin and yang. Would Jesus be, in your presentation, a little bit more on the yin side? That's unfair, right? Or is that the challenge to the West, which is, let's look into the face of the yin Jesus?
Yeah. Once I suggest in my book, the coming Jesus will have the characteristic of yin rather than yang.
Yeah.
So, I'll stop there.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So I think the always young Christ is not fair.
Right. Would you say
we should have feminine Christ? Too.
Right. But you would you say that the young Christ is more prevalent in the West?
Young Christianity.
Young Christianity.
But some big Greek important the theologian of he's a mystic Benedictine monk who lived in India for a long time, and he suggests we need in Christianity.
Uh-huh.
So young Christianity has dominated for a long time, and it became very aggressive and so forth.
Yes.
So we need in Christianity.
Yeah.
So in same. Manner, I may anticipate that coming Jesus can be in Jesus rather than young Jesus.
Yeah.
You never know.
Right.
You never know. But I think it can be a more fair.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Okay, Tudor, your name? What is your name?
Nathan. So you talked about how eco-Daoian thought can be a valuable corrective to transhumanism. And so much of transhumanism seems to be related to the denial of death or trying to overcome death. How do you see the role of death in Taoist thought?
Okay, I think I understand you are getting it, but not so clear. But anyway, I'll try to answer. I think I may have to explain further the distinction between echo joy and techno joy. That is Thomas Berry. Thomas Berry is kind of the pioneer in, he was a professor at Fordham University. And his student is Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Green. And he really worried about ecological crisis is coming. And so he tried to find out resources to remedy or change our attitude. And then he thought there are two great traditions we can use to ecological crisis from philosophy or theology and kind of the way of thinking. So one is Confucianism. The other one is indigenous spirituality, Indian, first people in US kind of thing. So he sent Mary Evelyn Tucker to Colombia to study Confucianism, and then John Grimm to Native Indian study. And they are now the kind of glue for ecological movement in US and the world. And Thomas Berry think there are two kind of great movement of human thought. One is realizing the crisis of Earth and planet Earth, ecological disaster, so go into eco joy, try to recover and survive sustainable kind of ecology. And the other, techno joy, is still using science and technology. So for me, I don't think Thomas Berry know that before he dies, but now transhumanism is the one who really continue on techno joy trend, the Thomas Berry Hotel some times ago. So my point is, transhumanism, you understand transhumanism, right? Transhumanism say it is end of Homo sapiens. We are the subject to change our next step of human evolution. That is post-human and so on. So we use AI and robot and maximum use of technology. And then they think human bio body has a lot of problem. And then they even say death is not kind of given. death is just a disease. We can control death. Now death is option rather than our destiny, kind of thing. So that is kind of the transhumanism, which is, in a way, equally problematic for ecological ecological crisis. That is kind of a lot of brilliant people in the best institution of education in the world are doing that. And then even Google and Amazon and whatever, and Google is now actually starting that. So in that degree, I see ecological consciousness is very important. And then critical monitoring of transhumanist movement and development and science and technology is very important for us to look at. So as a kind of a way, I suggest EcoDAO. For transhumanism, I suggest TechnoDAO. In other words, technology is now not only for the sake of technological advancement or human genius in technology fulfillment, but we should have a kind of DAO, morality, ethic, or humanity. The big problem artificial intelligence right now is if coming super intelligence, you really have the problem. So now the problem is how we can, we don't have much time right now. Super intelligence is coming already, then we have to somehow accommodate human value in artificial intelligence. The question is now, we don't know what is a human value. So issue right now I see is, what is the humanism or a notion of humanity we have to reestablish? So I strongly suggest Neo-Confucian and Confucian and Tao tradition, which is the longest tradition for anthropology and humanism. Christianity tend to negate or reduce humanism or anthropology because of imperatives to stress upon theology. So speak about God. For example, doctrine of original sin is kind of thing. So we have to be simple to justify the righteousness of God. On the contrary, in Confucian tradition, they reject human being was originally sinful. Rather, they endorse human being is originally good. Their argument is, if human being is not originally good, how can you become? How can you trust human being? How can you have the foundation of ethical imperative behavior? So that is kind of different. So I argue for techno-DAO. So even technology, we have to have. The another historical example is every technology, almost every technology before 15th century originated from East Asia, China. But because of Tao, benevolence is kind of a, yen is kind of key term, they cannot use that more than human relationship of the common goodness for humanity. But the Christian West brought that technology and then they developed gun and warship and so on, and they invaded China on the contrary. That is actually originate from China. So that kind of distinction. So in other words, the expansionist attitude of the Western Christianity has something to do with that. So now I'm trying to argue for we need Tao inside, even in the field of technology, so techno-Tao. In that side, I argue for techno-Tao, and in ecology, I propose eco-Tao.
Well, thank you very much.